Hello to you all. Hope you're enjoying the festive period. Like for all of us, it's been very different to normal years, but I hope you've had the best celebration possible with those friends and family that you're able to be with, in spite of the latest restrictions. 2020 has gone by so quickly in some ways, but who would have thought as we clapped the NHS on our doorsteps in spring, pulled together, helping each other out in our local community, followed the scarecrow trails and struggled to get delivery slots for grocery shopping, plus the novelty of Zoom church, we would still be facing the virus threat at this end of the year. Here we are about to knock on the door of 2021 in just a few days' time. The theme for our service today is a thoughtful reflection on hope, light in the darkness. I think at this unusual Christmas time, we've had more of an opportunity to pause and to think about the first Christmas over 2,000 years ago, and less about the razzmatazz of commerce, and remind us more about the birth of our Lord Jesus and sharing God's love with our human family, extending to those who are on the edges of society, struggling through having little, or who are anxious, alone or afraid. I look forward to future Christmases where we can again rejoice that God's eternal love is present to everyone in our world, given to us as a wonderful present, living in all our hearts and minds throughout eternity. I wonder if some people's attitude has actually changed towards Christmas over the last few weeks or months. I've been talking to a few people about their thoughts on Christmas this year, what traditions they liked or have liked, and those they didn't, and those they might like to introduce. So, Mike, what Christmas traditions do you really like and why?
Well, I used to love walking down to St. Michael's to the midnight service, because you used to meet some lovely, lovely people, and everybody was so happy. And on the way back, you would chat and wish everybody a happy Christmas, and it was just beautiful, and the service was beautiful.
Ah, oh, lovely. So, what Christmas traditions do you dislike, and why?
Well, that's one of the main gripes is Christmas starts too early. I mean, I've seen people selling things in shops in November, for goodness, early November. To me, they should make a law that you can't start any Christmas time selling things until 12th of December. Why 12th? I don't know, but.
All right. Okay. So what new traditions might you like to introduce and why?
Well, I can't think of anything new traditions, but maybe bring back the old chestnut man. But the only time you see chestnut people is if you go to a fair. Wouldn't it be nice to see like a person wheeling a trolley down and selling chestnuts door to door, as it were? We wish them a very happy Christmas. That'd be lovely.
Oh, that's great, Mike. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Helen has asked me to tell you about some of my favourite and least favourite Christmas and Advent traditions. I think my favourite Advent tradition is our family Advent calendar, which I've been doing since Anna was about three. We have one of those fabric ones with little pockets, and I always fill the little pockets with something different every year. To be honest, it's not usually massively expensive things. This year it was all craft themed, so we could make our own Christmas cards and Christmas decorations. But often we find that December can be a bit cold and damp and miserable and dark in the mornings, and we find that the excitement of peeking inside the Advent calendar really gives us a boost and helps us get through December. My favourite Christmas traditions all centre around Christmas Eve. I really love Christmas Eve, and I think it's this sense of expectation and the build up and the excitement. I like to get up really early and get all of my preparation for Christmas done as early as possible. And I normally have a race with my next door neighbour, who's also called Helen, who can finish all their Christmas preparations first. We know who's won because when we're finally ready, we'll put on some more festive clothes and we'll go to the other person's house and take our Christmas presents for the children. And it's always a bit funny to see who got ready for Christmas first. When I've done that, I love to come to the Christmas Eve service. To me, it's the most magical of all the services we do around Christmas time because, again, it's this twinkling evening light, that sense of anticipation in the air. And I just think it's really beautiful. Afterwards, I go home and I get to host Christmas Eve in our family. So my parents normally come round and Anna and I love playing hostess. And we've always made sure that there's silly games and special foods. And normally it's something like a jigsaw and a board game. And it's just a really lovely family time. And because my mum usually hosts Christmas Day, it's nice to just make sure that she gets some time on Christmas Eve to actually not hostess and not do the washing up. In terms of least favourite Christmas traditions, that's quite hard because I love Christmas and everything about it and everything about Advent. But for me as a Christian and a modern mum, it's a case of getting that balance. So some of the more modern Christmas traditions, which a lot of young families do, we've chosen not to do, like Elf on the Shelf and the Christmas Eve box. There's absolutely nothing wrong with them, and I don't have an issue with them at all. But for me, it was just a very conscious choice just to try and simplify Christmas as much as possible so that we focus on the things that really matter to us and really keep it as close to the meaning of a Christian Christmas as we could without too many stresses and distractions and expenses. Particularly for me as a mum, there's a lot of running around to do, a lot of teacher presents to get and a Christmas bazaar to help out. And there's a lot of stuff at Christmas. And for me, it's a case of keeping it as simple as possible for my own sake. So I have a little bit of time to think about what Christmas is actually about. In terms of new Christmas traditions, this year, Anna has got very into her Christmas crafts and Christmas home decor and Christmas baking. And because I'm quite a crafty person, I'm really looking forward to doing more and more together as she gets older and make Christmas cakes together and Christmas puddings together and decorate the house for Christmas together, all of which we've done since she was little. But I think it's going to become more and more fun and more relaxing for me as her mum as we get older and we can do those things together. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Growing up at Christmas time, I think a lot of traditions, as with many families and children, revolve around food. I knew Christmas was coming when I walked in the front door one day and my mum and dad would have been peeling onions ready to pickle. And the smell just hit you as soon as you walked in the house. And Christmas afternoon wasn't Christmas afternoon growing up in my house without a cheese and pickled onion sandwich. I really miss those. Another food is pickled walnuts. We used to get up every morning at Christmas Day. And every year, without fail, we would have boiled bacon that my mum made the night before and pickled walnuts for breakfast. Well, I liked the pickled walnuts, but I didn't like the bacon. That was my least favourite tradition. Even today, Mick and I try and buy a jar of pickled walnuts, although nowadays we do have it with cheese rather than bacon. I also used to love being allowed to go into the front room where we lit the fire, which we only used really on high days and holidays, and we were allowed to roast chestnuts. I remember one year my brother was doing it with me and one jumped out the fire and burnt the carpet. Dad wasn't too happy. I think a tradition I'm going to start this year, particularly as it's been such a weird year, is to try and make the effort to phone people. Not to just write a note, but actually pick up the phone and make a connection. I hope by the time you see this, I would have done that. And we'll carry on every year, just keeping in touch with people I haven't spoken to for a while.
In the bleak midwinter, frosty wind made moan. Earth stood hard as iron, water like a stone. Snow
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I light this candle, which symbolises hope for the coming year, a light in the darkness. Fill us with strength as we are gathered together today to worship and praise you through this most difficult of times, and let your light shine in us as we face the complexities of the future. Let the candle flame be an expression of the intensity of our faith and love for one another, secure in the knowledge of your everlasting love. Guide us as we ponder your word and fill our prayers and thoughts with your brightness and wisdom on this day of Christmas time. Amen.
Hey, little guy. It's okay, Mum.
Everybody, listen up. There's this huge guy with two dogs coming after Mary, and if we don't do something now, then the baby's not gonna... Oh, looks like you guys handle it. Sweet. The seat taken?
Everyone, this is Mary and Joseph. That's their new baby.
The flock is growing.
No, not happening. Don't even think about it.
It's okay. Let them in.
Look with your eyes!
See? He's just a baby.
Oh, look at him! Thaddeus, are we good dogs now?
We have to try.
I'm sorry, is this your stable?
No. We've come to honor the new king.
I'm sorry, king? Where? What is he talking about? A king?
What's his name?
His name is Jesus.
For Jesus, gold.
Myrrh.
Do you guys like frankincense?
I never know what to get.
Thank you.
For the newborn king.
We're never gonna hear the end of this, are we?
And I hope we never do.
You know, I think people are gonna remember this night. What happened here around this manger will be celebrated for thousands of years. Families will come together and exchange presents and sing carols, all to remember the grace of this moment that we are witnessing right now.
Okay, Deborah.
She's back to talking crazy again.
Hey, it's okay. Thank you. What have you been up to all night, Bo?
Bernie is now going to bring us the Old Testament reading. It's from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 to 7.
To us a child is born. The people who walk in darkness shall see a great light, a light that will shine on all those who live in the land of the shadow of death. For Israel will again be great, filled with joy like that of reapers when the harvest time has come, and like that of men dividing up the plunder after they have won. For God will break the chain that binds his people and the whip that scourges them, just as he did when he destroyed the vast host of the Midianites by Gideon's little band. In that glorious day of peace, there will no longer be the issuing of battle gear. No more the blood-stained uniforms of war, all such will be burned. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. These will be his royal titles: Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. His ever-expanding peaceful government will never end. He will rule with perfect fairness and justice from the throne of his father David. He will bring true justice and peace to all the nations of the world. This is going to happen because the Lord of Heaven's armies has dedicated himself to do it.
So another Christmas has come and gone. And I'm sure it wasn't quite what we were expecting when we took the tree down and put the decorations away in January. Last Christmas seems longer than a year ago, to me anyway. It was interesting to hear Zoe's, Mike's and Wendy's comments about traditions. In our house, it tends to be croissant for breakfast, nice and easy and quick, especially as the grandchildren have been eating chocolate since about 6 in the morning. One tradition that bothers me slightly, though, is the arrival of 3 kings, along with the shepherds, to worship the baby Jesus lying in a manger in a stable. Abby Guinness, in the Advent book A Child Is Born, which we have been studying here at Zion, tells us there is no mention of a stable anywhere in the Bible. We are told that Jesus was laid in a manger and also that shepherds visited him, having been told of his birth by the angel Gabriel. Matthew chapter 2 also tells us that the wise men followed the star which stopped over the place where the child was. Verse 11 says, on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary. The notes in the NIV say, contrary to tradition, the Magi, that's wise men, not kings and not 3 of them, did not visit Jesus at the manger on the night of his birth along with the shepherds. They came some months later and visited him as a child in his home. They did, however, bring 3 gifts, gold, frankincense and myrrh. Well, maybe I'm being a bit picky, because while the details point to different truths of the story that of that first Christmas is that God revealed himself to us in the person of Jesus. John Betjeman, the poet, says in his poem entitled Christmas, and is it true, and is it true, this most tremendous tale of all, seen in a stained glass window's hue, a baby in an ox's stall, the maker of the stars and sea, become a child on earth for me. And is it true? For if it is, and we as Christians most certainly believe it is, no love that in a family dwells, no carolling in a frosty air, nor all the steeple-shaking bells can with this single truth compare, that God was man in Palestine and lives today in bread and wine. So 2,000 years ago, who were the Jews expecting their Messiah to be? The word comes from the Greek Messias and means one who is smeared or anointed with oil. The Greek equivalent is Christos, which occurs 500 times in the New Testament. Expectations in the Jewish and Christian faiths can be traced back to God's covenant with David in 2 Samuel chapter 7 and the aftermath of exile and end of the Davidic dynasty. There was hope of God restoring a godly king to Israel. Some prophets foretold the coming of a regal descendant of David, portraying him as far more than a mere mortal. We heard in the reading from Isaiah of Israel being great again. There would be peace, as military equipment would no longer be needed. Descriptions such as child, son, wonderful counsellor hinted that the coming one, the Messiah, would be God himself. Many Jews were looking for a political leader to deliver them from Roman rule, while others were hoping for a saviour to deliver them from sickness and physical hardship. But the announcement the angel Gabriel gave to the shepherds concerns a saviour born in among the animals, because there was no place for them with the where the people were. So much for a descendant of King David, who surely should have been born in a palace. He wasn't even visited by kings, but common shepherds and foreigners who studied astronomy and astrology. The two were more closely linked than they are today in those days. And they weren't even Jewish. In the time of Jesus, Jewish law was still very important to the Jewish people. So they elected scribes who were excellent at explaining what the law meant, and they were very influential. In Jerusalem, the great Sanhedrin included the high priest and chief priests, 71 wise men who were mostly Sadducees, a smaller group than the Pharisees. They were made up of the rich and wealthy and were very anxious not to upset the Romans. They also tended to control the temple. The Pharisees were really important in the Gospels, as the ordinary people looked up to them as experts in Jewish law and tradition. Then there were the politically activist group, the Zealots. Their slogan was, "No ruler but God." So you can imagine they were very opposed to Roman rule, wanting to protect the Jews from Roman traditions. And there were also the farmers and fishermen, the common folk. All these groups had heard teachings about a coming Messiah, and everyone was waiting for the promised king to arrive. So the teachings of a carpenter from a scorned place like Nazareth really shook them up and required them to think outside the box. We know that Nicodemus, one of the Pharisees, came to speak to Jesus by night, but John's gospel doesn't tell us what the outcome was. Some of the crowd who welcomed Jesus on his triumphal ride into Jerusalem on a donkey on Palm Sunday were probably in the crowd that shouted, "Crucify him," on Good Friday. They didn't get what Jesus was all about. Thank God for the wise men whose discovery of the birth and journey to find this special baby assures us that all are welcome, and if we seek him, we will find him. And what about us? Are we going to stay with a cute baby in a manger on the front of a Christmas card? Or are we going to make a commitment or a recommitment to our relationship with the Lord in 2021? A relationship with a loving, forgiving, generous but challenging God. Mike Pilavachi, an author, charismatic evangelist, and co-founder of Soul Survivor, tells us he made his decision to become a Christian in his teens. He walked up a hill to be alone, read John Stott's little book, Becoming a Christian, and prayed the prayer at the end of the book. He knew that it was a big moment for him and that everything had changed. He says, "I didn't feel anything, but I just knew a transaction had taken place. One moment I wasn't a Christian, and the next moment I was." He also said, "For some who've been brought up in a Christian home, I fear they don't really get the wonder of their salvation and how amazing what Jesus has done really is. Whereas I knew what it was like to be completely without God and then to be completely with God." So we need to know our need of Jesus. Finding him is open to anyone who is looking, and he will be found in different ways that are available for the seeker. Next week, I believe, is a covenant service when we will have the opportunity to make a transaction, a covenant with God, as Mike Pilavachi did. Jesus can answer all our needs. He brings love, joy, peace, comfort, hope, and so much more. He also instructs us to share this good news with the Saviour of the world. The Saviour of the world has come to earth. We cannot properly follow Jesus in our own strength, which is why he also gives the help of his Holy Spirit to those who ask. The Holy Spirit will enable us to go into the world as Christ Jesus himself and to follow in his footsteps. The Spirit will also develop the gifts necessary to us for showing Jesus to our friends, family, work colleagues and strangers. We will hopefully meet them more in the coming year. St. Paul tells us, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come." So let's take a short time of silence now to see what God is saying to you and to me. I wonder if you remember the Andy Williams song, "It's the Most Wonderful Time of the Year." For Christians, Easter is more important because Jesus was crucified to take the sin of the world upon himself. Jesus conquered evil and its ringleader when he died on the cross and rose again, victorious 3 days later. Death and sin no longer have a hold on the human race. Then there's Pentecost, the birth of the Christian church and the coming of the Holy Spirit to equip Christ's followers to live out the new life we have in him. But then we couldn't have either Easter or Pentecost without Christmas. The birth of a baby in Bethlehem, laid in a manger and visited and worshipped by shepherds who'd heard about him from a choir of angels. How marvellous is that? So much more than just good news, I think. Light in the darkness and hope for the world. That is extraordinary, fantastic, wonderful news. The maker of the stars and sea become a child on earth for me and for you. And now we're going to take that time of silence and see what God is saying to you and me. If you don't think he's saying something in the silence, maybe he will speak to you through a chorus from the Messiah, which will follow, or one of the carols which come after that, or even something a friend will say to you later on.
Let us pray. There is hope, for our God is a God of hope. Trusting that God's light can penetrate any darkness, we pray in hope for our world and those we love. Pray with me, using the prayer response. God of hope, shine your light upon our world. God of hope, you have granted us the use of five senses through which we experience your world. You have blessed us with sight, hearing, touch, smell, and taste. Create in us a sensitive spirit, open to sense the beauty of your creation and able to sense the suffering and sorrow in it. God of hope, shine your light on our world. During this Christmas period, we see the glitter and magic of Christmas lights. Help us to see how people, animals, and even the very soil of the earth suffer. Help us to see with your eyes, compassionate God, so that we know how to help. God of hope, shine your light on our world. At Christmas time, we hear the cheerful chimes of bells, carol singing, and crackling logs. Help us to also hear the victims of violence and warfare. Open our ears to the cries of distress from families and children in our community, sighs of tension between co-workers and colleagues, words of misunderstanding between friends and neighbours. Help us to listen patiently and offer your peace. God of hope, shine your light on our world. During this festive season, we will taste many delicious things and fill ourselves as we feast with those friends or family with whom we are able to meet. Help us to remember those for whom this period has a taste of bitterness, disappointment, and grief. Pour your sweet blessing on them that they might taste the refreshing cup of assurance. God of hope, shine your light on our world. We smell the wonderful aroma of Christmas trees, mince pies and mulled wine. Help us also to continue to smell the pollution we have inflicted on your world and the stench of poverty. Help us to work towards a remedy so that we may smell again the freshness of creation and the wholeness of humanity. God of hope, shine your light on our world. This is a season of love. We haven't been able to hug or kiss or touch our beloved family and friends as we normally do. Remind us, Lord, of those whom it is difficult to touch, difficult to reach out to. As we make our own journey through the tough times we're living in, help us to extend a compassionate hand to the outcast, the poor, the stranger, the sick and the suffering. God of hope, shine your light on our world. May our Christmas experience of senses in sight, sound, taste, aroma and touch remind us of the birth of a child proclaiming your love for the world. Amen. And now our prayer of thanksgiving. Dear Father God in heaven, as we pray today, we just want to thank you for keeping us safe throughout the past weeks of lockdown, so full of scary news, statistics and uncertainties. We've made it this far because of you, Lord, as we live through the last few days of December 2020, considered one of the worst years ever. But we're still thankful because you are always there for us. You keep providing all our needs to nourish us and giving us strength when we feel weak. Lord, fill the coming weeks with healings and miracles as we give thanks for the science that has developed vaccines to lead us back to something of our normal lives. In Jesus' name, Amen.
I have chosen O Little Town of Bethlehem because I love the words of verse 3. God so wants to have a loving relationship with each one of us.
The reading is taken from the New Living Bible, Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 to 17. Since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness and patience. Make allowances for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts, for as members of one body you are called to live in peace, and always be thankful. Let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with all the wisdom he gives. Sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
As this is the last service for 2020, I suppose it's a New Year's service, really. So I'd like to finish with part of King George VI's New Year's message in, I think, 1939. And I said to the man who stood at the gate of the year, "Give me a light that I may tread safely into the unknown." And he replied, "Go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God. That shall be to you better than light and safer than a known way." So I went forth, and finding the hand of God, trod gladly into the night. Journeying forward with God doesn't guarantee plain sailing, but Jesus has given us the promise that he will be with us through all the storms of life, and also the promise of his Holy Spirit, who is sovereign and works as he pleases in his renewal of the human heart, it says in John 3. He will equip us to lead the Christian life to the full, described to us by Paul in his letter to the Colossians, which we read earlier.
Let us say together the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen.